Baca with the Houston Parks and Recreation Department, talking about some of our projects, some of the issues we've been having, and then what we've been trying to do to resolve some of those. So,
let's see if we can turn it on first, right?
Okay. So, just a little background about us. We have about 38,000 acres in the city and outside the city, actually. But that's managed and unmanaged land. About 17,000 or 18,000 acres in natural areas, but a big chunk of that is taken up by Cullen Park, and which is actually leased from the Army Corps, and then Lake Houston Wilderness Park also, which is almost 5,000 acres. Right now we have about 100 acres in five parks that we're doing restoration at, or gonna be doing restoration at. And this is kind of a map of them. Hopefully you can kind of get an idea of where they're at. Most of them have been on the east side of town because that's where we've had opportunities to do so. Hobart Taylor, if you look, this is, it doesn't work on TV. That's 610 and that's Elwood 8. So it's kind of on the east side. Hobart Taylor, Milby Park, we're doing some riparian restoration. Finn Park, Prairie, Stewart, and Blackhawk are both prairie also. So those are ones that we're working on right now. So this is Clinton Park. This is one that we've been going for almost 2 years now. And we've had a lot of you guys have came out and helped us plant stuff out. So it's looking pretty good. One of the things that when we were trying to figure out what we were doing is, you know, where do we find plants from? And I think that's a lot of the issues that we have. So, you know, we have so many experts in the area. We talk to people who are growing plants, who have collected seed, and that sort of thing. So we talk to them to figure out what we need to do. And so one of the main things is finding seed. We just didn't want to buy seed from Kansas and other places. We wanted to look for as local seed as possible. And so, you know, there's seed collecting trips all the time. As we're wandering around the city and other areas, we find, you know, remnant pockets of things. We find different species that are just growing out there that we try and collect seed from, especially if we're looking for them. So we really wanted to get some diversity in our plants. So with the help of Tom Solomon and others, and Flo and others who've been growing plants for a long time, we've tried to learn what they're doing and take advantage of our greenhouse. So many of you have been to our greenhouse we have at Memorial Park. It used to be used a lot more for ornamental ornamentals, you know, things that would be planted in Herman Park, downtown, other places. And so when we had quite a bit of staff reduction in things, we had a lot of open space. So Kelly and I were, you know, thinking, well, let's take advantage of that space and start growing some native plants. And so far we've had a lot of success. About 9,000 1 gallon pot plants since March of last year. Over 740 volunteer hours. Many of you guys have volunteered with us. And right now we have about 42 different species that we're growing, either in our greenhouse or the lab house, which is the outside area. And then we get these plants planted out. So many of you were at Clinton Park last year. You know, all these plants right there were things that we grew from seed. We had volunteers come out, we get people out, and we try and get them to help us as much as possible. So we've been looking for opportunities to find, you know, different species and try and grow them, especially locally grown ones. And then, you know, that's actually what's going out to our restoration sites. We've donated to other groups, other opportunities. This is University of Houston downtown, Johnny Goyen Park. So it's actually a city park, but the University of Houston downtown has wanted to do this prairie area right down there. So this was last fall. You know, we donated a bunch of plants to this. And, you know, this is what it looks like. And I think this was May. So this wasn't too long ago. But it's hard to tell. You can see some of the grasses that we planted in there, but there's a ton of weeds. You know, just imagine right next to the bayou, you get all sorts of seeds that are coming in. So this is one of our, that's some of our projects that we've been working on. One of the biggest issues, like I was talking about, was finding plants. And so with all the resources that we had, we were able to take advantage of seed collecting, looking for different species that we could grow, because, you know, we all know there's kind of your basic dominant grasses in a prairie. So we wanted to add, we wanted to grow a lot of those in addition to other things, because prairies and stuff are quite diverse areas. You know, there's also, one other thing I didn't quite touch on was seed. We've added some seed to a lot of these areas. One of the issues we've had with seed is just it's hard, the seed has a hard time competing with the non-native things. So we use seed in a lot of our stuff also, but I think we see a lot more success from the live plants that we've been growing. Your wildflowers, some of your annual stuff grow well from seed, and we try not to spend too much of our resources growing some of these annuals and other things in our greenhouse, like with our pots and soil and other things, because you know that stuff kind of comes and goes on its own pretty easily. So most of what we've been trying to grow has been, you know, perennial things, perennial grasses, perennial forbs, and other species there. Perfect time. So what's next? So we have, most people who live in Houston are used to these parks as like a mowed area with trees and a playground and that sort of thing. So when we're introducing these prairies, tall grass, people are constantly thinking, well, you're just bringing more rats and snakes and mosquitoes to your area. And so it's, that's been one of our biggest challenges right now, trying to increase the public perception of that. And with all the outreach that we do and with all the outreach that a lot of you guys are doing, I think it's been helping. It's been kind of a slow and steady process as we move forward. So Clinton Park is one that's looking pretty good right now. The people who live right next to it aren't very happy, but hopefully we can work something out. Okay, I'm done talking. We've got more signings that we still have to do. I think that's another thing we're working on.
Could you give a quick update on Sylvan Rodriguez Park and the pothole restoration?
Well, that's interesting you asked about that. We've got about 3 grants that we're trying to put in for now for restoration in those areas. So right now we don't have anything actively going, but we're seeking funding to start doing this.
Jen, as individual citizens, how can we to share the understanding of what's going on here, why this is a good thing?
Well, I think one of the best things is if you can volunteer and learn about it yourself. I mean, doing all this work, we couldn't do it with any of the, without any volunteers. I mean, it's me and Kelly, and we have Cassidy as an intern right now. So you know, we're trying to do all this stuff on our own. Volunteering is helping as you learn. And being able to do that and share that with people you interact with is very useful, as much as possible.
It's a very opportunity for the city to work with entities like the railroads. We just encountered a problem last week with the butterfly count here in town. Herbicide spraying along the Memorial Area railroad tracks. You know, there's some really nice remnant prairie there. Apparently, some of that really got pasted.
There's a lot of, there needs to be a lot of work on communication between all these groups. Even within the city, Public Works is doing their own thing, we're doing something different, and nobody wants to work with each other. So we haven't overcome that hurdle yet, but it would be, I think if we can, that would be, we would accomplish a lot more too. Because you know, the center point, right-of-ways, and all sorts of other things that are out there, great opportunities. But I think it's just a communication issue that we need to figure out how to work through.
How do you get volunteers? I mean, what kind of strategies to get volunteers?
Well, we started out by coming to some of the groups like Master Naturalists, the Native Plant Society, and others to kind of share what we're doing and what our opportunities are. We've also started an unofficial natural resources kind of email update that we try and send out. So if anybody of you want to receive that, you can. Just let us know. That's kind of the route we're going right now. Facebook, sometimes we'll get our events posted on Facebook and other things too. So
I took his plant ID course. It was a great outreach effort and I got a lot out of it.
What was that?
I did a plant ID workshop thing. It was kind of a small little thing, and he enjoyed it.
Using the UH downtown as kind of an example for the non-native grasses and other species that have come in, do you kind of make peace with that, or do you have, I mean, or, and you trust that the biodiversity will be maintained with the plants and seeds that you put in there, or are you making an ongoing effort to manage those more non-native invasive species?
I think it's going to be an ongoing effort because it's not fun to walk through and get sand burrs all over your clothes. So I think it's going to be an ongoing effort. I don't, you know, we haven't been in it long enough, and some of you may have been in it longer. You know, can these natives or will these natives outcompete some of these areas that we're starting from scratch? And so I think over several more years, we may find out, you know, if we're able to continue to plant and seed in that area, how well are they going to outcompete the non-natives that are in there? That's a really tough situation because Buffalo Bayou floods, as some of you know, and that brings in all sorts of seeds that, you know, you never knew existed in the area.
Are you making it known to various types of volunteer organizations that you have seeds and plants available, or is your seed plant bank primarily for city parks?
Well, we're trying to expand as much as possible. So right now what we're doing is most of what we've been giving to has been city park projects or city property projects that other groups have been working on. For example, UH Downtown, they're kind of the ones running that. There was people who wanted to add a native section along one of the trails right behind his house. We donated a bunch of plants to him to, because it was on city property, he just wanted to adopt it. And so there are opportunities for that right now, and we're really looking to expand because what we're trying to do is use all the things that we're growing right now for our projects that we're working on. So it's kind of a, right now we're just using it for our stuff. Potentially we could expand if we can find some space for some of that.
Right, that 5 minutes is up. Now it's just for us to talk, right?
Now it's for you guys to discuss kind of restoration of city parks, Jed's issues with finding native plants and all of that stuff. This is a crowd thing, kind of thing. And anyone can start the conversation. It's not directed. So Jed can't say anything at this point. So you're going to have to talk amongst yourselves.
So I have an issue that I've encountered with Exploration Green in Clear Lake, and also I'm concerned about Sylvan Rodriguez Park, which is off-road vehicles getting access to these sites.
Yes.
And how you keep them out without just putting up billboards that say stay away, we don't want you. It's just getting worse for us.
Really bad, a lot of holes.
Very bad.
People, ATVs, like doing donuts all over the place.
I know my research plots on Memorial Park, back on the running trails, what we had to do was put up a fence. And you can still see it. It's still visible. It's still trying to interact with people as they go by on the trail. But it does have some keep out. And if they go through it, it's still fences. So can they drive it through? Yeah, but they're probably going to tear up their off-road vehicle if they try to. So
I think, if I can kick in, because the little water hole I'm very familiar with, it's a combination of things. You don't put up the signs, you got no legal basis to do anything, right, first of all. So put up the sign. Put up a fence, absolutely. And if you can do it in such a way that you can do a little funky little gate deal that's not a gate, that will keep you, you can't get an ATV through it, but you get people through it. And do those kinds of things. That'll go a long way towards actually slowing it down, totally not being able to do it.
I'm wondering if the idea of some of these plantings that are smaller, I understand now that when that one floods, that would be a problem. If you made them more like actual gardens, you can design kind of more of a design with native plants, and they, especially in smaller areas in any town, in the city, and the pocket prairies, smaller pocket prairies, with more gardenish, or more like an intentional planting instead of a meadow, that would help not only educate, and for those people who don't like that wild look, which seems to be a problem for city officials and neighbors and stuff, that would start trying to do a little of both.
I'll talk on that one since Jed's not allowed to talk. So the University of Houston downtown one is sort of like a smaller one that can be done at. That's really the slopes there. They're managing that one. Our other smallest one is 7 acres, and they went in the one, since you took a picture of it.
So I think some people just, you know, we try to do outreach to them, and some people just don't want it there. But for that one, we did. And the fence looks really nice, and so we tried to like surround that with something to make it to show that that was a prairie, and we have a turf roof on it and everything out there. And so we know what we can. But it doesn't matter what you do in a park. Somebody doesn't want something. Somebody doesn't want a ball field here. Somebody doesn't want. So we encountered that with Southern Rodriguez because they were doing the master plan for that. And everyone just argued, but we had a bunch of people write in about it. And whenever they, and a lot of our partners, probably many of you in this room wrote letters about that, and they changed the master plan to be a natural design. And so they took most of the development out, and then they presented that to the community, and the community members were really excited. That wasn't even in their thought process at first, so they changed it based on the letter, and everyone's really excited about it. But I think whenever you sort of incorporate that into the plan, and it depends on the neighborhood too. Clinton is not the best neighborhood, but Southern Rodriguez is next there late, so they're more prone to that type of thing too.
Right. Also, I'm gonna